هاش أدرك كيشي وسيارة شايون أنا أدرك كيشي وس علي.
Well, when I started creating the Dothraki language, along with the material that was in the books, which was key, I think the next point was I started to investigate other cultures that had approximately this, the same level of technology that the Dothraki had. So, for example, there is, or at least there was at one point, no word for book in Dothraki, because the Dothraki didn't have a written form of their language, and they didn't, you know, have paper, they didn't have books, they didn't have anything like that, so it wouldn't make sense for there to be a native term for that. The nice thing about the new season of Game of Thrones, now that we have a language like High Valyrian, is that Dothraki is able to borrow from words from there, because they'll know what books are. They will be in contact with these civilizations that have books. And so what they've done now is they've actually borrowed the word for book from High Valyrian. There are a lot of Dothraki sounds that I think would be familiar to English speakers. So like, you know, K and G are pretty much pronounced pretty much the same as they are in English. But a lot of the sounds that are in the front of the mouth or pronounced with the tip of the tongue, called on the alveolar ridge usually, are pronounced at the teeth. So for example, if a Dothraki speaker were to pronounce the word taco, they would pronounce it taco. Well, Dothraki has some similar swear words to many of the world's languages. Most languages have swear words related to something like, you know, excrement or parts of the body. Everybody's got those. But Dothraki also has something that's, you know, slightly different. So, for example, if you said to somebody, you know, Yer ifi vinrach, it's translates to, you know, you walk like a little boy. And the thing that's so offensive there is not so much the little boy part as the walking part. It's really offensive to call somebody, you know, refer to them as a walker, because, you know, if you're a Dothraki, you ride on horses or you don't go at all. Anhatih ave es yeri. Anhavus adriv mai, which is, I saw your father. I did not kill him. For the languages of defiance, the thing that I was asked to do from the very beginning was that the two main languages I was creating, Arathian and Castathan, had to be audibly distinct from the get-go. And so what I decided to do with them was I decided to make them polar opposites. So sound-wise, they sound very different. One, Arathian is spoken rather slowly and kind of musically. Castathan is spoken at kind of like very swiftly and haltingly, kind of like, you know, like a machine gun in bursts.
Oh.
Okay, Haigi. Le magi kala izushiru to make it irashedulu haipaku. Kwadinkya!
Even as I'm developing these languages that were already complete before they got to Earth, now I get to the point where I can evolve them as they're on Earth. So it borrows, the languages borrow words from English, English borrows words from those languages, they all borrow from each other. And also as kids are growing up that were born on Earth and weren't born on the old worlds, they're actually speaking their own languages differently from their parents.
It is the human custom.
The most important thing when creating a naturalistic language, at least one that's supposed to appear like it's a realistic looking language, is to include that element of historical depth. Without that, it's just really simple to just produce a fake language, something that doesn't look very authentic. By adding the element of historical depth, you're able to produce something that's authentic, that's realistic looking, and has all the quirks and irregularities of a modern language. If there was one language that isn't like really fleshed out that I could work on, and kind of like, you know, expand, I think I would choose the language of Jabba the Hutt. That guy is just too cool. I love that dude.